Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 25th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from James Dornan. Agenda item one for the committee is to consider whether or not to take agenda items 3, 4, and 5 in private this morning. Is the committee agreed?
Agreed?
We are agreed. Thank you very much. And the second item on our agenda is consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland's briefing on Scotland's colleges 2024. So can I welcome to the committee this morning our witnesses. We are joined by Stephen Boyle, Auditor General for Scotland. And alongside the Auditor General is Mark McPherson, who's an Audit Director at Audit Scotland. Tricia Meldrum, who's a Senior Manager at Audit Scotland. And Sheila Stewart, who's an Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. You're all very welcome. We've got a number of questions to put to you this morning, but first of all, can I invite the Auditor General to make an opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm very pleased to present my latest briefing on Scotland's colleges. Convener, colleges, of course, are vital to students, their local communities, and the wider economy of the country. For a number of years now, we have highlighted risks to the financial sustainability of the college sector, and the scale of financial challenge has now increased since our briefing of last year. Grant funding from the Scottish Government through the Scottish Funding Council accounts for around 3/4 of the college sector's total income. The Scottish Government's funding for the sector remained static in cash terms for 3 consecutive years, from 2021-22 to 23-24. Followed by a cash terms reduction of £32.7 million in this year's budget 2024-25. This equates to a real terms reduction of 17% in funding over that period. Staff costs account for around 70% of colleges' total expenditure. Scotland's colleges are making redundancies to reduce their costs, but funding for these departures also represents a further short-term financial pressure. In 22-23, just under 500 staff left colleges under voluntary severance arrangements at a cost of just over £12 million. Colleges are responding to the financial challenges they are facing in different ways. This includes implementing financial recovery plans to reduce their cost base, and in the report, the briefing rather, we give some examples of the steps that they are taking. However, colleges and the Scottish Funding Council are becoming increasingly concerned about cash balances in the sector and what that means for the liquidity of individual colleges. These financial challenges mean that colleges are facing difficult choices around the curriculum that they provide, the workforce that they employ, and their use of their land and buildings. To help colleges better plan and to help them target for this reducing funding, Scotland's colleges, in our view, need more clarity from the Scottish Government on the aspects of their wide-ranging roles and responsibilities that they need to prioritise. Convener, I've also highlighted that the Scottish Government has made limited progress in implementing the reform of the post-school skills sector in the country. Groups have been established to take forward reform, and the Scottish Government is developing an overall plan. But what is expected both in the short term and in longer term isn't yet clear. Progress in taking forward recommendations, for example, on regional arrangements has also been slow. And consultation relating to the arrangements in respect of the Lanarkshire and Glasgow regional arrangements closed in September 2024. But that was 4 years after the Scottish Funding Council recommended changes. The lack of progress with reform, as well as the need for clearer priorities, is causing continuing uncertainty and making it more difficult for colleges to plan effectively. I've made recommendations that should provide colleges with a clearer basis for planning for financial sustainability. And as ever, Convener, my colleagues and I look forward to answering the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Could I begin by just asking an information for really to get an understanding of why in the report is it that there are a number of colleges whose annual audit reports are not included? I think they are UHI colleges and Forth Valley College. Are there reasons for that?
Yeah, you're right, Convener. Just to, for the record, so our report covers the incorporated colleges in Scotland, and I think just to get the right page reference, Exhibit 1, we set out the colleges that are included in my responsibilities to appoint the auditors for, and then there are a further handful of unincorporated colleges that I'm not responsible in, and traditionally we haven't included those. Specifically in this year's briefing paper, there were six sets of colleges accounts that weren't available for us to draw on the overall results to inform it. And as you mentioned, Convener, those are Forth Valley College, Inverness College, Lewes Castle, Moray, North Highland and Perth. A number of those colleges are in respect of the University of the Highlands and Islands college auditing appointment and auditing arrangements. So there have been some delays in completion of the audits for those colleges. And I think it's also it's been quite a challenging year for the completion of the audit and the preparation of the accounts. A couple of factors just to highlight for the committee, and Mark might want to say a bit more about this. One is in respect, it's the first year of the audit rotation and appointment arrangements. That always requires a little bit more investment from both the finance teams and the auditors. Part of the raison d'etre that we have this rotation is to allow a fresh pair of eyes from the auditors. So that had brought in some delay. There's also elements of capacity within finance teams and of auditors to allow for the completion of the audits. But one of perhaps the most significant factors, Convener, is that as there have been delays, what happens is that new information becomes available that's in respect of the finances of the college that the auditor has to take a second look at, and I'm specifically referring to pension arrangements. So when new pension information, and it's always a complex area, that then comes back into play, as it were, the auditor is required to spend more time making an assessment of that new material piece of information. Mark can say a bit more about the very latest position, Convener, but we are approaching the end of any outstanding information, and as I've alluded to, expecting that this will be a much more straightforward process next year. Martin, you want to add?
Just to say that we've since we've prepared the report, we've received a further two very recently, and we are currently considering the annual audit reports as we would do normally to see if there are any issues that we would like to bring to the Auditor General's attention and whether he might want to prepare any further reporting. The other four, I hope, we're going to receive sometime in this month, I think, is where we're at now. Just worth saying, I think, that we were still confident that the key messages in this report stand up, even with the 14, without the remaining six.
Okay, I understand that. On a separate point, I think, one of the things that came out of the evidence we took last year was that the Scottish Funding Council appears to hold a risk register. And I think the committee took the view and believed on the basis of a source, I think, that we had, that there could be five or six colleges coded black, i.e. With quite significant cash flow problems. Do you have any update on that picture?
Yeah, I'll bring the team in a minute. Mark may say a bit more, and perhaps Tricia to supplement it, Convener. So we absolutely know that there are colleges that are, you know, experiencing financial challenges. I think that's not just waiting on the Scottish Funding Council's position statement on that, which will come probably over the next few months, but we've seen it through our own audit work, that there are, you know, liquidity challenges, there are financial planning risks writ large across a number of sectors, and I think that allowed us to arrive at the overall position. Mark can touch on this, Convener, but what we haven't done is look to extract that information from the Funding Council and then reflect it in our own report. I think that's information that's held by the Funding Council, anticipate that that's something that they will want to, with the right caveats, bring into the public domain. I think the reason I'm being somewhat cautious, Convener, is that there is the position can change, and also colleges operate to an extent in a quasi-commercial environment, so they're not just public bodies spending money and then, you know, reporting it. Growing sense of homing in on individual colleges' financial results, given that they can operate in a commercial environment to bring in income, is something we're just cautious of the range of factors in here. I would expect that it's a judgment for the Funding Council to make, and you know, they will present that in due course, I'm sure, convener. But Mark can say more about some interaction that we've had, if that's helpful.
I don't really have a lot to add. I think the Auditor General covered most of the points I was intending to say. The variability and the fact that things can change over time. There are always, I think, or have a long time been small number of colleges who are under higher levels of engagement. I think that is how the Funding Council tends to describe it. So we continue to work with them, but they will be better placed to tell you how many or which colleges.
Okay, we may well ask them, but I'm a little bit surprised given that the Public Audit Committee took evidence last year of this risk register existing, and there being anything between 4 and 6 colleges on it, which is quite a substantial proportion of colleges, and against a background of you reporting, you know, quite significant reductions in real terms in the budgets of colleges, and a trend I think you identified last year of a growing number of colleges in a precarious financial position. Why aren't you in regular liaison with the Scottish Funding Council to get an up-to-date picture of the risk register as they see it?
So I can bring Mark a second. Just to reassure you, convener, we are in regular liaison with the Funding Council, and the Funding Council, say, can give the most up-to-date position, but it remains the case that there are a handful, or slightly more than a handful, of colleges in Scotland that the Funding Council consider to be on their highest level of engagement in terms of their financial position and their liquidity. So I think for me there's a consistency with what we're setting out in today's report and the Funding Council's understanding of the challenges that the sector and individual colleges are facing. What we don't have for you today is the itemised list of who those colleges are.
I can say a little bit more. I'm very cautious about saying it for the reasons of things change very quickly and can change very quickly. But we understand from latest information, I think colleagues will tell me if I'm right, that there are 4 colleges with whom the Funding Council is in higher levels of engagement. But as I say, that can change, so just very cautious about that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, look, we've got more questions about funding, and I'm going to bring in the Deputy Convener to pursue some of those lines of inquiry. Jamie.
Convener, my apologies. Can I just clarify? It's 6 colleges that the Funding Council, rather than 4, are having higher level engagement with.
Okay.
Apologies for interrupting.
No, thank you for correcting the record. Thank you. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Auditor General and guests. This is a really important subject, the importance of the college sector to the experience of young people in Scotland, workers, and the general wider economy. I think you've highlighted very well in your report. So I think, first of all, I want to drill into some of the meat and bones of the numbers here and the state of the funding. I'll use the word crisis, but I'll leave it to others to use their own language. So you mentioned in your opening statement that we had 3 years of cash freeze, and then this year a reduction which overall would equate to around 17% real terms reduction in funding. but what I'd quite like to tease out is what you think the effect of that has been. I obviously haven't been on the committee for a number of years, but it's certainly an issue that's been raised over a number of years by Audit Scotland. So it's not a new problem, but it seems to be getting worse, is my impression. I wonder if you could elaborate more.
Yeah, very happy to, Deputy Convener. I think just to perhaps to draw the committee's attention to Exhibit 2 on page 8 of the report, where we set out the cash and resource funding that the sector has received from Scottish Government budgets over the course of the past 4 financial years. So that kind of illustrates, I think, the point you make in your question, Deputy Convener. Flat cash for 3 of those years, followed by a cash reduction, and across the piece that represented where we get to a real terms reduction of 17%. You asked about the implications of that, Deputy Convener, and I'll bring the team in a moment if they wish to develop my responses. What that's meant is, I guess, a number of things is that if you're receiving flat cash and then a cash reduction, you have to manage your expenditure to maintain financial balance. We've spoken in recent times about Scotland's colleges are now public bodies, so it means that they're not able to hold reserves in the way that they once were. We also in the report address kind of some of the legacy reserve issues from what's called arm's length foundations, where kind of some of the reserves were moved as a part of charitable arrangements. I'm happy to come back to that over the course of this morning's discussion. So you don't have reserves, your income is reducing, but your costs aren't reducing. So what we've seen, particularly the sector, you know, difficult discussions around pay arrangements with trade unions. Some of that has, you know, made progress in a way that we've seen over the past year that had been really stuck. So your costs are increasing by virtue of, you know, fair pay arrangements that they now employ. And colleges aren't immune to the kind of wider pressures that individual households and other public bodies have been facing in terms of, you know, prevailing rates of inflation, cost of goods and services. So as I mentioned in the opening statement, they've had to balance their books by employing voluntary severance arrangements in the sector. 500 people left the course of college employment this year. And also the wider implications of what that means. So in terms of learner experience, the provision, the breadth of courses that are now on offer. And I'll maybe just round off before opening up to colleagues, is the positioning of Scotland's colleges. If, as is so regularly identified, and drawing on the work that Colleges Scotland did with the Fraser of Allender Institute, is trying to put some numbers around the long-term benefits that Scotland's colleges and people who, you know, benefit from attending a college then on provide to the wider economy, both in the short term and throughout their working career. So all of these, you know, factors that the colleges provide are having had to be looked at by colleges this year. So both short-term, medium and long-term implications while they're managing a cost reduction programme. But as I mentioned, I think the kind of, one of the key points in today's report is not having that kind of wider strategic clarity about what their role is from government thus far. So I'll pause if you're content, Deputy Governor.
Just to sort of summarise that. So you've got a situation where the cash was frozen for 3 years, then there's a cash cut, which has an obvious effect on their day-to-day balance. But in light of that, you have increasing costs, you have pay awards and other general uplifts to their operating costs. So they're having to make cuts, clearly. And it seems to me that the lion's share of those cuts have been made in staffing reductions, which clearly leads to a reduction in course choice, breadth and availability. But has there any analysis been undertaken on what the wider economic effect of the reduction of the courses has? Because clearly, if you're not upskilling and reskilling and training people to the levels that you used to, then that's obviously having a negative effect on the wider economy. I mean, surely you can't lose 500 teaching staff from the college sector and have no net effect on the level of education that the colleges provide in Scotland.
Yeah, so I think, again, I'll invite colleagues to develop my response. We haven't done any analysis ourselves thus far on what kind of short, medium, longer term implications are of members of staff leaving colleges. I don't think it's too much of a stretch, though, to recognise the point that you make, that will likely have a bearing on course choice, learner experience, and then particularly the economic implications of courses not being available, people not being there to teach them, and then learner throughput, both for the experience that it affords people, the additional skills for them to take their career once they leave the college thereafter. But I think particularly in the committee, we'll be familiar with having taken, you know, considerable evidence on this point, that colleges play a vital role in the local economies of the areas that they serve. And areas are different. So, you know, so what might be required in an Ayrshire college will be different from what Northeast of Scotland College will provide. So it's how those choices are made about where to make cuts. Is it being done with the clarity and support that the college sector says that it needs, and then the advice and prioritisation that the Funding Council and the Scottish Government is providing the sector? And I think for us, that's the gap that we're seeing, is that lack of clarity about the strategic positioning of colleges to play their part to support economic development and a thing I wouldn't want to lose sight of about learner experience as well, about what that all means. I mean, Mark, if you want to develop.
The only, I don't know if I'll develop it much further, but I think that the key thing is that colleges are obviously working hard to minimise impact on the experience for learners and their curriculums, but that is becoming ever more difficult given the financial pressures that they face. Again, as the Auditor General has said, the need for absolute clarity about what is the top priority for colleges to help them make decisions about both the learning and the other services that they provide.
So it's interesting, I mean, the college sector is quite different. They obviously provide further education, but quite a large chunk of higher education is provided through colleges. 26% of college education is higher education, 74% is further education. But equally, what's very different to the higher education university sector is the mode of attendance. So a large proportion of people who attend colleges are there as, as part-time students, and that's perhaps reflected in, for example, the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, which was an example of a government intervention which sought to encourage small, medium-sized businesses to reskill and upskill their workforce. And I understand around 24,000 students participate in that programme. But, for example, that fund has been removed as well. So I guess this all points towards, I would say, a worrying picture, and I'm not, I certainly wouldn't want to put words in the mouth of Audit Scotland, but I'm sensing a sense of frustration that this is something that's been raised repeatedly over many years, but we can't just keep coming back to committee year after year and Audit Scotland tell us, you know, there's real concerns about the liquidity of colleges, there's real concerns about the level of education that they provide, there's real concerns about the lack of strategic role that colleges play in Scotland, yet you check the official report and year after year that's exactly what the Auditor General is telling us. So where do we go from here? What would Audit Scotland's recommendations be?
So you're right, there has been a recurring theme of reporting from me, and I think in truth from my predecessor as well, about, you know, the growing challenge that Scotland's colleges are facing. So, you know, we regroup after each publication, Deputy Convener, you know, and take stock what we've published previously, the progress against our recommendations, and then what we're seeing from the evidence that the auditors are presenting to us through their annual reports. So I think that allows us to say the challenges are increasing, that the recommendations that we made over recent years are still valid, but there is an increasing urgency. I think, you know, so we would absolutely recognise that the government has been clear about, you know, its prioritisation programme for government has set out in terms of, you know, tackling inequalities and also economic growth. Colleges do both these things as well, but I guess we're not seeing is that translated into the clarity for the government to provide to help colleges prioritise and for them to position themselves both locally and for the sector across the piece. So I think that's the kind of the state of play, and perhaps maybe just a couple other things to mention, Deputy Convener, was helpful. And you mentioned the change to the flexible workforce development funding for the committee's awareness. We're currently concluding some work on public service reform and fiscal sustainability. We'll get into a bit more detail on some of the in-year budget management choices that the government is making, and we'll be publishing that next month. So I look forward to briefing the committee. We'll get into just some of how the choices are made and the wider implications of those. I'll pause there, Deputy Convener, actually.
Thank you. You mentioned just in the previous comments about these six colleges, and I appreciate you don't want to name them because the situation may change as further audits come forward or analysis is done on their finances, but it sounds like they are in quite a perilous financial position. What would happen, what does happen when a college simply runs out of cash as a public body?
Yeah, so Mark can come in a second, actually, but I think to say, so there is a... So typically in the, you know, if an organisation is trading, and I'm saying organisation in the general sense, not specifically to a public body, the directors of the organisation have to make an assessment about its going concern. And very clearly there are implications for the auditors in such circumstances. The auditors to take a view of the director's own assessment is effectively how it works. And then to make appropriate disclosures in the annual report and accounts, to make confirmation to their shareholders and so forth. Not a perfect analogy, but I think in a public sector context, the concept of going concern is much more general. It doesn't specifically relate to the individual body. Instead, it relates to the provision of the service. So we've seen over the years that there can be, I think the kind of, apologies for the terminology, but mechanisms of government, effectively, that you know you can change the structure of the public sector, but the service ultimately continues. And that saves the need for the directors of the public body to make going concern disclosures. Specifically, Mark can touch a bit more about the role of the funding council, as he wishes. A lot of that responsibility falls to the funder and the funding council in terms of the engagement support that they're providing the college, the adequacy of their financial plans, the role that the Board of Management is playing. There is even a route for the funding council to provide additional cash to the college, but there's not a lot of money in the funding council for it to do so. It's not sitting on pots of reserves that can sweep in. So to all intents and purposes, I think the financial challenges, the results of that are what we've been seeing setting out in the report, and through reduction in courses, voluntary severance schemes, to find a way of balancing the books. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's fair enough.
But I mean, you can only cut so far. There must come a point when you simply can't pay your bills. You can't operate the buildings, you can't pay your staff, you can't buy anything, you can't replace anything that's broken. If that was a business, it would go bankrupt, it would close. But in a public sector environment, I'm trying to understand what happens there. I mean, would the funding council simply loan them cash if they have no reserves? Could the colleges themselves borrow money? Or would it simply be that some of them could close altogether?
So Mark can say, I suppose, really what the playbook is of the college and the funding council in those range of scenarios. It's really challenging, I think, and I think perhaps just to illustrate, to a degree they are somewhat boxed in, because as I mentioned earlier on, 70% of spending is on staff costs. So that's, I think, why we've seen the focus on reducing headcount as a quick way to balance the books. But then, not to repeat discussion already, but the other implications of, if you're taking quick decisions to balance the book, it's obviously got wider implications about the provision of service. But I'll pause and bring Mark in just to say a bit more about the funding council as well.
I mean, I think you'd be looking at a hierarchy of intervention, effectively. So could some short-term injection of cash, get the college back on its feet, re-establish the sustainability? You'd obviously be looking for some sort of recovery plan in those instances. The next step, I think, would be for if that wasn't going to solve the issue, would be for some of the things that the Auditor General talked about to be considered by the Funding Council in conjunction with the government. What is the way in which we can continue to provide these services? That may mean a restructuring. It may mean a temporary shift in the provision and who leads on that provision. But those are really decisions that would have to be made by the government and the Funding Council. I think those are the sorts of questions that might be worth exploring with them.
So one solution would be simply more cash to the sector from the government, for example.
I think more cash to any public body would be welcomed at any time, but I think we know what the financial position is across the public sector in Scotland at the moment. Mm-hmm.
It's maybe worth also drawing out, so kind of bring Tricia and Sheila in. I think it wouldn't be accurate to depict the role of the funding council as one as waiting to be called to intervene. I think that they have been proactive. I think, particularly, I guess, referencing some of the changes to the funding model that the funding council has brought in this year, changes in the 24-25 financial year around the outcomes framework, just some of the constraints. That's the wrong phrase, actually. Some of the obligations and mechanism that in respect of course credits, how they were linked to income, what was expected of colleges. I think it's fair to say, and pass to colleagues to say a bit more about this, there is more flexibility now for individual colleges than perhaps we would have once seen. But again, I'll pause if anybody wants to say more on that.
So one of the one of the risks to colleges is around the term is clawback. So if they don't deliver their credit target, then the SFC could be asking for funding back. So the SFC has implemented some changes around that model to increase the thresholds so that it's not such a tight target. So that gives a bit of protection against that clawback of funding going back to SFC. They've also introduced some other changes around increasing that kind of financial flexibility to colleges. The changes to the outcome agreements are around giving colleges a bit more flexibility again, around setting their own priorities and not having such predetermined targets set by SFC, so for them to align things more with their own kind of strategic planning. So the SFC are doing other things to aim to support colleges through this, and obviously working very closely with colleges and individual colleges where there are particular pressures.
Thank you for that. I might point members and the Auditor General's attention to a written question which I submitted and got a response to just late yesterday afternoon. It's question number 3005, particularly on ahead of today's session. We asked Minister Graham Day around to comment on your report, and we did receive a reply, but it was quite illuminating, I suppose, perhaps into the government's thinking around some of the issues we've just talked about. But the Minister says that it's the responsibility of each college to manage its operations in line with its funding, and we expect them to reassess their models and explore avenues for cost reduction in the second paragraph. But in the first paragraph, also say that we recognise the role that colleges undertake in development to their students, but also Scotland's economic growth. The two statements seem to not exactly match up, shall we say, but that's perhaps a comment rather than a question. I may come back in later to talk about wider reform, but I'm sure others have questions in the meantime.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to invite Graeme Simpson to put some questions to you. Graeme.
Thanks a lot, Convener, and good morning. I just want to stick to this list of six colleges that are being worked with by the Scottish Funding Council. Are they included in the 14 that you've got audits for?
So I'll ask colleagues just to confirm if we have that information. So I don't think we have that read across, Mr. Simpson, between the six and the but I think it's something, but I don't think so is the answer. It's probably something either we would need to take away or the Funding Council and ourselves would need to discuss to see if we can do that cross-reference.
Are you saying you don't know which colleges are among that six?
So we're saying we don't have the information as to whether or not the six, the college accounts that are missing are the ones that are subject to higher level intervention. I'm being a bit guarded. I think the answer is probably isn't. I think that, but I don't have the precise detail of that to hand, unfortunately.
So, I'm not clear. Do you know which six are on that list, or not?
So, I don't think we do, unless colleagues can tell me otherwise.
Okay. So all you know is that there are six.
It might just be worth pointing out that this report is, of course, based on the 2022-23
yes.
annual accounts, and whichever colleges that are engaged with now will be a significant, potentially a significant different position than it was a year ago when the accounts were prepared. So matching the two is, you know, as I say, this is the six are in the now. This is from a prior
period. I understand, but you don't know what the six are.
No, I don't think so.
And indeed, I think when we asked about this last year, I think it was, we weren't told either. So you don't know. Have you asked?
So I think, I guess it's for a different purpose. You know, so the college, the Funding Council will be engaging with the sector. They'll have their engagement arrangements. I don't think it changes really where we're at, Mr. Simpson, in terms of the work that auditors are doing and the assessments that they are making, looking at the financial challenges that they're seeing through their work. What I would expect is that there'll be a read across, but I think Mark's point's important, is that there are timing differences here. So events can happen quickly in the college sector, and I wouldn't want to kind of draw any false conclusions at the point of, you know, where we've made our judgments on, which is information at our disposal at the end of August 2023 from these, mm-hmm. these financial statements relate to, than what could be a current up-to-date position of engagement that the funding council are making.
So have you asked for the list or not?
So we've got the number, but I don't think we have the current itemised list.
Will you ask for that list?
So we can, we could ask for that list, you know, and I'm sure the committee could ask for that list as well.
We could indeed. Because I think, I mean, I personally, I just don't like to play this guessing game. And I think we should know which colleges are in the most perilous state.
I think it's important that some of the safeguards necessary are recognised in that putting that information into the public domain could have implications for some of the commercial arrangements of that college. I say they are, it's not, I say, an entirely appropriate equivalence to some other public bodies. And so they are competing to generate revenue with other organisations. And I can understand why there is some degree of caution about making that information public. But again, it's something that I'm sure can be explored further.
Okay, you're right. I think it needs to be explored further. Right, so can I ask then about the redundancies mentioned? You've already mentioned it, of course. We've had 496 staff who left in the year that you've looked at through voluntary severance schemes. Is there a breakdown of the roles of these staff? I mean, do we know how many were teaching staff, support staff, other roles?
I'll bring Trish in to say a bit more, Mr. Simpson, about if we have information on the analysis across different roles and specialisms. Perhaps maybe just first of all highlight to Committee Appendix 2 of today's report, where we analyse the number of staff that have left individual colleges together with the associated voluntary severance cost up to for the year 22-23. So as you mentioned, just short of 500 people, mm-hmm. left college employment at a cost of over £12 million. So, but I think Tricia can say a bit more about some of those arrangements and any further detail that we have.
That information is drawn from the annual accounts, and the annual accounts don't break it down into whether or not it's teaching staff or support staff, so we don't have that breakdown into what makes up that 500 people.
Where would we get that information? Because I think that's quite important to know. Because obviously, if you're looking at teaching staff, that can have an impact on the curriculum. So, and we kind of need to know, you know, is this continual downward spiral of staff, is it going to affect the delivery of the curriculum?
So we can look at what further information we have if the accounts of colleges analyse that by teaching staff or support staff. I don't think it's too much of a stretch, Mr. Simpson, to say that does have a bearing on course provision. Teaching staff inevitably will make up the majority of that number, and that has an implication for, you know, the choice that that colleges offer to learners, and then the wider implications of what that means for the role in supporting economic activity and development in their areas.
Are you just assuming that most of these will be teaching staff, or do you actually know that?
So I don't know. I think, as you said, we don't know the detail. So I don't think I'm taking too much of a risk to say I think, you know, that will cover, you know, a significant proportion of teaching staff, and that then will have a bearing on course provision. But we would need to get the detail of that, and if we do, we'll share that with the committee.
Okay. So then has there been any analysis done about the impact of this on course delivery? Have we seen courses being cut?
So we haven't done that analysis yet. I think that's something that individual colleges, together with the funding council, will will need to do. And I think you'll see, perhaps just referring to some of the arrangements that those oversight bodies was kind of deploy, particularly the Funding Council, they employ an oversight of voluntary severance schemes that colleges are deploying. They also need approval from the Funding Council if they're looking to escalate that into compulsory redundancy arrangements. So I don't know if I'd call it a safeguard. I think it is oversight that's being provided by the Funding Council. But for me, it doesn't really move us away, what I would say, from the kind of overall judgment that we make in today's report, that there's a lack of clarity across the piece to help colleges prioritise in making some of the difficult financial decisions that they're making, be it redundancy and then the implication on course provision.
It sounds like we may have to follow up with the SFC about that as well then. Anyway, we can discuss that later. Right, I was looking at on page 13 of your report. There's a list of different colleges, so I'm just looking at New College Lanarkshire because it's in the area that I represent. Has a deficit of -3.6 million, which was up from 1.8 million the previous year. 60 staff left the college under voluntary severance. That cost 1.2 million, but it didn't deliver the recurring savings budgeted. So I suppose from that, I hope I'm not making too big a leap. Is there a risk, not just at New College Lanarkshire, but other colleges, of compulsory redundancies coming down the line if they find that they haven't actually managed to make the savings using the voluntary route?
I wouldn't want to be specific about New College Lanarkshire, so I don't have the up-to-date information on their financial projections at the moment. So I'm trying to be quite considered in my language in response to Mr. Simpson.
Quite right.
But I think it is the case across the sector that if voluntary severance arrangements or any of the other cost reduction mechanisms don't bring the colleges expenditure and income profiles into balance, one of the tools at their disposal, subject to engagement and approval from the Funding Council, would be to look at compulsory redundancies.
But that hasn't happened yet in any colleges, has it?
Tricia?
Or has it?
It not in the year that we were looking at. So we were looking at 2022-23, but we know that one college did implement some compulsory redundancies in later than that in 2023-24. So it's not included in this report. But following some industrial action, those compulsory people who were made compulsory redundant were subsequently offered voluntary severance or reskilling, retraining, etc., and alternative posts within the college. That's the only college we're aware of that has introduced voluntary compulsory redundancies. But as I say, those people were then reinstated or took voluntary severance.
Which college was that?
It was Clyde.
Clyde. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Just going back to New College Lanarkshire, because in that section, it says that it's working with SFC around a financial recovery plan.
Yeah.
Do you have any details of what that involves for that college?
I'll pass to colleagues if we've got more insight on the detail, but I think, just pulling ourselves together on that one, I think what it's something we've seen of the Funding Council. So they do have a role in such circumstances to look at the cost base of colleges, the comparability of cost, staff numbers, ratios and so forth. So they'll be looking at the various arrangements and individual colleges' recommendations for how they might bring themselves back into financial balance. But if we've got more detail on New College Lanarkshire, Mr. Simpson, we can share that.
We don't have any other detail about what is in the recovery plan and what kind of level of
recovery plan in terms of higher level of engagement either. We just do know that they are working with the SFC.
Okay. I think that's something else that could be of interest, especially if there are other recovery plans out there from other colleges. I think the committee may take an interest in that. Can I just go back to, you mentioned the the regional boards and the situation with the Glasgow Regional Board, and you said that the consultation on that closed in September.
That's right.
Do you know what happens next and what the timescale is?
You're right. Colleagues can say a bit more about what we know. Sometimes this can be quite a variable process, a conclusion of a consultation. It will be for government, together with the partners and the funding council, to take stock of the range of responses that have come through on the consultation. Allow me to make perhaps the point I made in my opening remark again, Mr. Simpson, that it's taking a long time to resolve the regional arrangements that we have in Scotland. I can park to one side, quite different, I think, those regional arrangements for University of Highlands and Islands, which are a different set of circumstances. But for Glasgow regional arrangements and Lanarkshire, similarly, going back 4 years since the Funding Council made recommendations that these needed to be resolved. So it is progress that there is now consultation from government, but it's taking a long time. So I think it would be good to see that process resolved quickly for the benefit of the colleges themselves, clarity for what they're there to provide for their learners and staff. But if we have more detail on timescales, we can share that. But as I suspect, I don't think we're quite sighted yet as to kind of what comes next following the consultation of last month.
Okie doke. I'll just ask you finally about arm's length foundations, because I always ask you about that. So we've seen over the years that the money held in these funds, I suppose you could call them, has gone down quite significantly. 99 million in 2014, that's when they were first set up, to 12 million in 2023. And that's forecast to drop, according to you, to 9 million this year, which is 9% of the original balance. Can you just tell us where the money originally came from for ALFs? And do you have a record of what colleges have applied to spend the money on?
So Mark has a lot of the history, having been involved in this, so I'll bring him in a moment. So the origins of why ALFs exist, and you'll be cited in much of this, Mr. Simpson, I know. These, prior to colleges becoming public bodies, they were able to hold reserves. So from the range of their trading activities, the funding that they had received over the years, that they had accumulated and were managing their financial position and operations from one financial year to the next. So broadly in that territory, without getting into the specifics of individual colleges and what was the source of their revenue, that when they became public bodies and the mechanism that was established so that the money wasn't entirely lost to the college sector, arm's length foundations were set up as separate entities from the college, charitable purpose to support the provision of the college activity, that there has been a flow of money from the colleges, as you mentioned, £99 million in 2014 through to £12 million at the end of August 23 and forecast to reduce further. That trajectory is not surprising to me. I think that's broadly what we would have expected to see, that the money was used over the course of the past decade to support the colleges and their wider activities. But it remains, as the money's forecast, so 9 million next year and who knows where after over the next few years, the money is running dry in terms of arm's length foundations being an alternative source of revenue to support colleges' wider objectives. And I think it just illustrates that once you've used it, it's gone. So there isn't another, really the kind of mechanism for colleges' wider activities about how they can kind of come to a stable financial position. In terms of what it was used for over the course of the piece, I don't think we haven't got that analysis in front of us today, but it's something that I think probably the colleges themselves will be better, or the Arms Length Foundation's accounts will be better able to say how they have discharged their responsibilities, I think.
Well, I'll ask you a question that I think I've asked you before anyway. There was some confusion around what the money could be spent on, i.e. what it's allowed to be spent on and what it's not allowed to be spent on. And I think my recollection is you were going away to get the answer to that. So I just wonder if you could put on the public record what the answer is.
I just would you mind kind of asking me the question, actually, about, is your question,
well,
what are they allowed to spend
on? What are they allowed to spend it on?
Okay, so I think Mark has the detail, and I'll pass them, but I think probably as I've mentioned in my kind of previous answer, is they're wider related activities. So I remember the discussion I think we had was, can they use it to fund redundancies and so forth? So I'll bring Mark in just to kind of be absolutely clear about what our understanding is, what Arms Length Foundations can do, recognising that I think probably quite reasonably there will be a degree of variation between depending what their originating articles will have said about what this individual Arms Length Foundations can and can't do. So, Mark.
Yeah, I think the Auditor General's preempted what I was going to say, which is it will depend on the individual ALF as to what the money is allowed to be released for. We do know that in the past, colleges, I think, have used it to fund severance arrangements. I don't know if that still stands. The articles, I guess, could change over time too. We don't have detailed information, unless it was specifically mentioned in any of the annual audit reports, as to what individual colleges have applied for, whether they've been successful, in fact, or otherwise. But the Scottish Funding Council, I think, does engage more closely with colleges around the use of ALFs.
I think Tricia's got a little bit more detail, Mr Simpson, just to perhaps give the committee a more of a flavour about what has and hasn't been included.
It's historic information, so it's from the last time that we looked at ALFs and reported on it, which was our 2019 report, but it might give you a flavour of how they've been using it. So at that time we reported that they were typically using ALF money to fund voluntary severance, capital works, investment in equipment and investment in digital infrastructure. So that it is a few years old. We haven't looked at it since then, and we don't get any of that information through the accounts or the annual audit reports, but just to give you a sense of how it has been used in the past when obviously there was more money available in ALFs.
That's interesting then, isn't it? Because if colleges are using ALFs to fund redundancy, at some point that money's going to run out and they won't be able to fund redundancy if that's the route they're using.
That they've been doing that this year. As I say, that's historical information from our 2019 report, which we've been looking at the accounts from years prior to that.
So I mean, in terms of redundancy, so I think in today's context, I think we're seeing redundancy as a mechanism to manage an acute position in terms of delivering financial balance in year. In other settings, perhaps a camera environment, redundancy is a mechanism, voluntary typically, is a mechanism to support transformational change or reprioritisation. So I can see how there could be a clearer read across. And I'm saying this without the detailed specific articles, Mr Simpson, of what individual ALFs have, about why there could be a case for why that might be used to support the wider objectives of a college. But as Tricia mentions, that was the detail that we had, go back 4 or 5 years ago. And there's maybe a case for, if the committee are interested about individual ALFs and what they've what they do and what they can and can't do.
Okay, thanks, convener.
Okay, thank you very much. And at this point, I'd like to remind members of my voluntary register of trade union interests. I've got some questions which move us on from those who've left and those who have been made redundant to those who remain and their treatment. And one of the points you highlight in this briefing is the outstanding pay dispute between the support staff, but then I think with even greater longevity, the lecturing staff. And I won't rehearse the politics of this, but it's something that has been raised many times with the government, that they stepped in with NHS staff, they stepped in with teachers, but seemed very reluctant to step in resolving this dispute. But the point you make in your briefing is about the impact that this has had on learners. And I wonder if you could perhaps give us a bit more information about your assessment of the impact that it's had on students and learners.
Yeah, very, very happy to convene an action. I think, if, as I recall, the committee has taken considerable evidence on this, roundtables where you heard directly from National Union of Students and their representatives about the impact that it had on, you know, and seeing either kind of courses change, familiar staff that they were receiving teaching and learning from moving on, and I guess some of the wider arrangements that it's had. You know, so I think we mentioned in today's report, but you know, some of the cost-saving mechanisms deployed, you know, changes to childcare arrangements within a college setting. So just what might appear kind of small savings, but actually very significant implications for some individuals who are accessing Scotland's colleges. If I may also convene, I'd just perhaps highlight the role that colleges fundamentally play to some of the most deprived communities in Scotland, that the vital role that they play in terms of social mobility. You know, so today's report kind of brings in that for people in Scotland's lowest socioeconomic class, nearly half of those who went to college and then on to university, they did so through one of Scotland's colleges. So it has far-reaching implications for the lack of clarity point about what are Scotland's colleges to prioritise in terms of their provision, the role that they're providing for learners, and then the wider economic point. What we've not done since previous reports is to, as we've done elsewhere, is actually to take an individual learner's journey perspective. We've done so previously, and we've, you know, we've heard the recent examples that the committee have about the significant personal implications that some of these changes are having on individual learners.
And it may not be your role, but maybe you could help us in pointing us to whose role it is, but it may be your role, in looking at the equality impact of some of these cuts to courses and the types of courses that are made available. Because, as you say, the colleges are a bridge for many people into employment, can be a bridge to retraining, frankly, can be a bridge out of social isolation. And so I wonder whether, do you have any plans to look at that? Do you think it's appropriate that another part of the infrastructure of the public sector looks at that so that we get a better understanding of, you know, the contraction in funding, which you highlight in the briefing, doesn't have an unequal impact, does it?
No, and this has been a recurring theme, I think, of my reporting over the past few years about where there are changes in funding revenue streams, that the wider implications of those are known before the decision is taken. And I think perhaps going back to COVID era, firstly, convener, and unfortunately continuing, is that still seeing examples of where funding changes are made, is that an equalities impact assessment hasn't routinely been considered before some of these changes are made. As I alluded to earlier, convener, it's something that we'll be reporting further, not specifically to colleges, but in our report next month. What I would say particularly about the funding circumstances here is that we expect decision makers to know those implications of changes to funding when they're taking the decision. What's happening at the moment, though, is that colleges are having to make decisions at pace to deliver a bottom line. And that's going to rub up against the time and space that they have available to make these decisions, because they have a financial imperative to deliver. And I think, regrettably, what we're seeing is that it's competing against some of the wider implications of their role.
Thank you. I just want to move on before I bring Colin Beattie in to one of the other delayed exercises here, which is the delayed implementation of the job evaluation exercise for support staff employed in Scotland's colleges. Could you give us an update on where that sits? Do you have a view on why it has been so slow to bring to fruition? And what are the cost implications of that?
Yeah, I'll bring colleagues in, convener, just to say a bit more about it, but perhaps just to develop some of the circumstances that you referred to. So the job evaluation for support staff was first identified nearly 10 years ago, in 2015-16, and clearly progress has been very slow, I think, is the judgment we make in the report. We know that the Colleges Scotland, College Employer Scotland, has plans to develop the path and milestones and working with the trade unions to meet that. That doesn't feel terribly satisfactory, I think, for people who are caught up in that and are awaiting clarity about their roles, responsibilities, what that means for the reward that they receive for doing those roles. In terms of next steps around that, I think I'll just invite colleagues if we've got any more detail on that, but clearly we'd expect that to be resolved soon.
We continue to engage, to talk to College Employers Scotland to get updates as that progresses. That's the latest information, is that they're having that dialogue. The resolution of the pay disputes, I think, has helped get people into, move things forward a wee bit, get things in a better place in terms of now planning for the next steps. But we don't have a timeline yet for when that will be resolved. Clearly, there could be potentially significant cost implications going back a number of years for colleges. So again, that adds to the uncertainty for colleges. They don't know how much that potentially will be that they will be paying out or when they'll be paying out.
But has the job evaluation exercise itself been completed, and have recommendations been made about job roles and the grade that goes with that?
Not as far as we're aware.
No. Wow.
I'm not sure we're maybe cited on the day-to-day developments in that process, convener. Evidently, there's a lot of catch-up to be done here to resolve it, but I think it's perhaps one for Funding Council or College of Scotland to give you an up-to-date position.
Yeah, but just on that expression, catch-up, I mean, do we know that the terms of the job evaluation, which, as you say, has been going on for nearly a decade, include back pay?
I don't have the detail of terms and conditions, convener, unfortunately.
And Tricia Meldrum, you don't know that answer.
That's the expectation.
Do you know how far back?
No. Sorry, no.
Okay, well, maybe there are other people we need to ask that question of. Colin Beattie's got some questions to put. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to look a little bit around the SFC funding model. Now, page 14, paragraph 29, sets out what action the SFC's taken to help take some of the pressure off colleges. And there's four main items there. One or two of them I think we've already spoken about earlier. But looking at these changes that have been put in place, the briefing says it's too early to say whether these changes will help colleges reach a more sustainable financial position. Do you have a view on the extent to which you consider they will help colleges?
I think, as we set out in the paper, Mr. Beattie, that I mentioned earlier this morning, that Funding Council is being proactive in discharging its role, both as leading the engagement of individual colleges, but also that kind of wider sectoral piece about how it can play its part to support its sustainability. I think the four bullet points under paragraph 29 give a bit more specifics about some of the actions that it's taking, both in terms of, I think I would frame all of those as affording individual colleges more flexibility in terms of the learning and financial implications and funding that they receive from the Funding Council. As you mentioned, we're also going to say, in and of themselves, are they going to be enough to help the college's wider financial position and the financial position of individual colleges? I think we don't know yet. So that if some of these arrangements don't come in till what will now be the new financial year, started on the 24-25. I think we just need to wait and see whether they're sufficient. And I say that primarily because not that these aren't good ideas, or not that they won't, you know, support flexibility, but if but will they be enough against that backdrop of 17% real terms reduction in the college's funding arrangements against their cost growth, you know, allowing for inflationary pressures, new pay arrangements that are now in place. So, so whilst you can see the progress, I just don't think we know yet whether they're going to allow for the financial sustainability of the sector.
But surely there must have been some assessment done that these were the appropriate steps to bring in, and that there would be an impact down the line, a positive impact. Have you seen these assessments? Have you seen these evaluations? If so, do they seem reasonable? Will they deliver?
So I think some of these will apply in 24-25, and yes, there will have been methodology and evaluation carried out by the SFC to forecast what the benefits that will accrue from them. I think, as I say, though, that I think it's too early to tell as whether or not it's going to be enough to resolve some of the forecast financial difficulties of colleges. Are they going to mean that a financial plan no longer requires changes to course provision or changes to staffing numbers in colleges? I'm not sure we're in a place yet to make that assessment. I think the funding council themselves, together with individual colleges, will be better placed to say, here's what we anticipate to happen. I think, rather than me speculating, I think we're in a wait-and-see position for the time being to see whether they'll of themselves they'll be enough. And I think that my position that's partly informed by it's not the only approach that the funding council is taking. I think as we go on to say further in the report that paragraph 29, that in addition to, my apologies, not paragraph 29, but some of the paragraph 37, I should say, of the, we mentioned in paragraph 29, as you referred to, the credit flexibilities, but also looking more broadly about use of assets within the sector and some of the wider costing arrangements. So that those approaches are also going alongside the credit flexibility suggest that in and of themselves they are not going to be sufficient to address the financial pressures.
Given the importance of these changes to the colleges and to potentially to their funding, did Audit Scotland look at all at any of the methodology and so on they used to arrive at their conclusions that these were the appropriate way forward?
No, that's not something we've done yet. Our briefing paper today is drawn on the annual audits of the of Scotland's colleges. What we haven't done, and it's open for me to do so, is to just to weigh up against my other priorities of whether to do a deeper dive, as it were, into some of the forecast methodologies and the benefits of those. I'll make that decision as I develop my work programme next year, Mr. Beattie. But what will inform that principally is some of the more detailed assessments that the Funding Council themselves have made. And just to highlight for the committee that the Funding Council are now in a rhythm of publishing their own assessment of the challenges and opportunities that Scotland's colleges face. And that, I think they published that early in 2025. So I'm sure, like the committee, I'll read that before deciding my own next steps.
Okay. In respect of the lower thresholds, do you know if that's likely to impact on the needs of students or local employers?
Perhaps I can bring colleagues in to say a bit more about the specifics of the approach.
We don't know specifically how it will impact, but it does mean that colleges can potentially deliver less learning because that threshold has been reduced and not risk clawback. So I guess potentially there is a chance that could reduce the amount of learning that they deliver. But obviously colleges are looking at their curriculum in the round as part of their ongoing reform, transformation, etc. So we'd expect them to be considering all of that in the round rather than just kind of randomly reducing some provision.
Yeah, I mean, obviously any reduction in learning is bound to have an impact on students and local employers. It's I can't see how it wouldn't.
If I may, I think that that feels like the core conclusion that we make in today's report, that there needs to be a space that the government occupies in giving clarity to the college sector, you know, and individual colleges through the funding council to help them prioritise. So we think, you know, progress in terms of affording them more flexibility around course credits and it relates to their financial position, but perhaps not yet that wider piece about how colleges, courses support individual learners, and then also that wider ambition about what it means for economic activity in the area and the country more widely.
I'd like to just move on to investment in the college estate. In your briefing, you state that the CIS delivery plan supports the development of an infrastructure investment plan, which apparently was due in November 24, but will now be later. Do we know how much later?
I don't know if we do yet, Mr. Beattie. I think has been confirmed by the government there have been some delays to wider infrastructure plans, allowing for the timing of the Scottish budget and what that might mean for the provision of capital funding for the sector. So as we mentioned in the report, it was due to be next month, but I think we're awaiting confirmation of new timescales for that.
But what's been the reason why it's been so delayed? I mean, obviously there's a degree of urgency in this, given, well, you know, it's across the public sector, there's a degree of urgency about some of the maintenance and so on that needs done. But colleges have been coming up now year after year. So why has it been delayed?
I think that's a question for the Funding Council about the kind of timing. I think my assumption relates to clarity of information of available resource to support capital investment plans. I don't know if I can say terribly much more that we know it is delayed, unfortunately. How important it is that it's available as quickly as possible, given that the use of the college estate, their land and buildings, plays a vital part in their provision of service, but also has a very important, you know, potential role about what it means for supporting financial position. And if I may just perhaps highlight to the committee one of the case study examples we make in today's report is in respect to Glasgow Kelvin College, a college that has taken land and buildings decisions to support its financial position. It's, you know, it's plans to dispose one of its campuses in the west of Glasgow to support its provision of service. But one of the discussions that's now taking place in the sector is, and then what happens to the capital receipts? You know, if colleges are making decisions to dispose of assets, it's not as straightforward as, you know, one might assume that, you know, a college sells an asset and they retain the proceeds. Typically in central government context, the money returns to the Scottish Government. So I think there's discussions ongoing, as I refer to paragraph 37 of the report, about asset disposal. Is there an alternative mechanism somewhere that, you know, sharing of the proceeds that can support transformation and sustainability? But I think it illustrates the point you make, Mr. Beattie, that needing to get infrastructure plan as soon as possible to support some of these planning decisions.
I suppose tucking the money away in an ALF isn't an option.
So I need to check that. Not as far as I know. I think a disposal proceeds are returned to the Scottish Government for wider consideration. But clearly there's, you know, it's important consideration if that could be used more directly in the body that's disposed the asset. But these are policy decisions for the Funding Council and the Government.
Thank you, Mira.
Okay, I mean, just on that last point, do you think that has that system has a behavioural impact? I mean, presumably, the board of Glasgow Kelvin have made a decision to dispose of that asset in, you know, the west end of Glasgow, which is a high value location. But if they don't necessarily benefit at all from the proceeds of that sale, where's the incentive for them to look at things like that? And obviously, that's replicated to other college boards across the country.
So that's a really important point, Convener. You know, I think about the motivation, the incentives around asset management in the round, about the level of sophistication that I'm sure colleges would want to deploy, and indeed probably what they were used to deploying before they formally became public bodies. So I think it's a welcome approach. I would say that the Funding Council is working with colleges to say, is there, allowing for the times that we're now living in, is there something that we can do to incentivise, to support better use of the college estate? I get, not just in terms of financial provision, but actually to support learner experience, the way that economic implications. But yeah, there's definitely something there to be looked at.
Okay, thank you very much. We've got a final couple of questions, which I'm going to turn to the Deputy Convener to put to you, Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. I'm going to try and mop up a few different areas, so bear with me. But really want to look ahead at the future off the back of the work that you've done to date. I had one very specific question, which I'm not sure you'll have the answer to, but my understanding is that colleges pay VAT. You may be aware of a letter written to the Chancellor of the Exchequer yesterday by the Association of Colleges, which I believe is an organisation south of the border, but may or may not include Scottish colleges, calling on the Chancellor to introduce an exemption for VAT for the college sector, which obviously is a reserved matter, but it's not alluded to necessarily in the work that you've done. My understanding is that around 3% of college cash expenditure is paid in VAT. It's obviously a high-profile subject given the changes to VAT in the independent school sector. Is that something that you might look at? Or would that be a positive in terms of their cash flow?
So I guess a couple of things. It is a reserve matter and it's also a policy matter. So probably on both counts, it really precludes me from expressing any view on the merits or otherwise of that. I think, though, that it doesn't perhaps prevent, say, look, there's going to be a need for innovation in some of the approaches and thinking that the sector and individual colleges deploy to both to manage their revenue and their cost base. So, but perhaps that's probably a bit the limit I can go on that point.
Anyway, it's a matter of record. But it does lead into the wider discussion about what they do next. It's clearly not sustainable. As you say, you talked about these colleges as going concerns. Well, they won't be going anywhere. They'll be very concerned, however, when they suddenly find that they're running out of cash. And as I said, you can only take cuts so far. So wider reform clearly has to be part and parcel of the conversation. Now, the college sector is not immune to reform. It's been reformed previously. You talk about its move to being public bodies and changes to the structure. We talked about a little bit today about changes to the financial models. There's obviously been amalgamation over the years and a reduction and an increase in the amount of colleges. So this sort of stuff does happen. And I appreciate some of it is policy, but it strikes me as that there's been a conversation about reform for quite some considerable time. The 2023 Withers Review, for example, made a very large number of specific recommendations which don't, in my view, seem to be going anywhere either. You express these concerns in your report. Can you elaborate as to why you think the government is not moving at pace with some of this reform?
I think we would observe that the pace hasn't moved quickly enough to give clarity to the sector about where they are positioned in the provision of teaching, learning and economic development. I think, so the first thing I would say, some of this stuff is complicated. You know, there are a lot of organisations that are involved, lots of interested groups and so forth, that means there needs to be appropriate level of consideration, consultation and so forth. I think where I've got to say, I'm not sure they've got the balance right on that, because it's taking too long to give clarity. All the while, colleges are having to make decisions in the here and now to deliver financial balance to meet their obligations. And as long as that goes on, I think you risk suboptimal decisions into the medium term that have just become necessary decisions for today to deliver financial balance. So, and there's always that risk that just to deliver balance, a course choice is made, a key member of staff leaves, and it's going to take a long time to recover that, and you may not. So why it's taking too long or why it's taking as long as it had, I think, is more a question for Funding Council and for Government. But I hope it doesn't detract from where we've got to, Deputy Convener, that, you know, that clarity is urgently needed for the sector.
I think that message is loud and clear, and it's been widely reported as such off the back of your report. But there is a sort of false economy to trying to make ends meet on an annual basis, simply to make your accounts fit for purpose. Redundancies come at a cost. We've talked about the educational, the social, and even the moral impact of making redundancy, but there's a financial cost to that as well. So in some ways, you're hoping it will save money down the line, but it's costing you money up front to effectively pay people off. So it seems like a very short-term fix to a longer-term problem. Is that a correct assertion?
Yeah, I think as I mentioned in opening remarks, that so £12 million was spent in the financial year in question to pay for voluntary severance arrangements. That could have been £12 million that was used for learner experience to fund other costs that are in an already challenged cost base.
Yeah.
So having to do that on a... Not a reactive. I don't want to say colleges have been reactive. They're not. We know that there are, you know, some quite sophisticated financial planning that's going on in colleges to manage a difficult position. But it's another cost challenge that they've got. So I think it all points to that. You know, it's really very difficult for colleges to continue to do this, to continue making cuts, to deliver a bottom line, notwithstanding the implications that it has into the medium and long term.
I've been listening carefully to some of the responses to the many questions you've had today, and I've written down some of the phrases that you've used. And the words that keep coming up repeatedly are slow to progress, limited progress, and lack of progress. Progress is a good thing, but lack of limited and slow progress isn't. Is there a reason why you use those phrases so often in your analysis of the Scottish college sector?
I think it's based on the evidence that we've seen over the past few years and in today's reports that these aren't terribly new issues. So, you know, it's not as if the financial challenges facing Scotland's colleges are first reported in today's report. I've said them for a number of years, as have others. And, you know, the Funding Council in particular, which I think is quite a healthy, you know, place for the Funding Council to be, that, you know, they themselves, as a government body, are also, I would say, making an objective assessment of the challenges that are facing Scotland's college sector. But I'd say there's enough evidence, Deputy Convener, that these issues have been around for too long and urgently need tackled.
Absolutely. And I think the role of colleges more widely is something you allude to in terms of a strategic plan. There's a little bit of talk about, for example, a new national skills approach, which we will see something in March next year, which might be a bit too late for some of the colleges that have been mentioned by others. Simplification of the funding landscape, regional skills planning, and all the sort of typical buzzwords you'd expect from, you know, working groups and reports of this nature. But at the root of it is actually what is the wider role of colleges in both education and the economic future. I was quite struck by some of the briefings that we got ahead of today. 33% of all college learning is in the care-related sector, care-related learning. So that's childcare, social care, healthcare, and 24% is in STEM subjects. Now, both of those areas are endlessly crying out for more people. We hear daily that there are shortages of people in both those sectors, both STEM subjects and in the care sector. Yet colleges are perfectly placed to deliver some of those skills and resource. But those are the same institutions which are facing cuts. This strike me as a slight imbalance in terms of the economic strategy of filling gaps in the economy, but at the same time pulling the plug on the funding for the very institutions that can deliver it.
So I think the illustrations you use are consistent with the message that's come from the sector and from their representative organisations, that they identify a need for clarity, you know, probing the consistency of approaches between the funding arrangements, the role of colleges, and how well placed they consider those entities to be to support, you know, service gaps for vital parts of Scotland's economy and, as you mentioned, equally care provision. So that clarity is at the root of why of what colleges are looking for, given the role that they provide. So very much recognise the point you're making.
Do you think there's a particular reason why the average spend on college students is substantially lower, for example, than that of secondary pupils or university students? It's around £5,000 per student in colleges, but £7,500 in universities, despite the fact that colleges deliver 26% of higher education learning. It's a real disparity in terms of investment in college learning.
Yeah, I'm sure there's analysis that kind of gets into that detail. Unfortunately, I don't have it to hand today, but I'm familiar with the statistic as to the differences and, you know, what that means in terms of the cost base of the different institutions is probably kind of some of the rationale for it, but it's not something we've looked at for the purpose of today's report.
And finally, I just wanted to close with that. So in my research for today's session, I came across an article in the Herald from the principal of Edinburgh College, Cumberford. I'm not sure if you've read the editorial, but it was an interesting and eye-opening piece that really touches with what we've been talking about today and the role of colleges and the funding situation that you refer to in your report. But I wanted to quote Audrey, and I hope she doesn't mind. The potential of the Scottish college sector is often misunderstood, undervalued, and as a result suffers from underinvestment. It's vital that we understand that colleges, for what they are, which is the cornerstone of the country's future prosperity. And I think that nicely sums up the conversation perhaps we've had this morning. I presume you agree with Audrey on everything she said there.
So the thing I would add is I think there was a very consistent message from an editorial from the now former head of Colleges Scotland, Shona Struthers, I think, who made similar reinforcing the role that her organisation, that colleges provide. And parallels, I think, with our own reporting, just the financial challenges that the sector is facing. And at the risk of repeating myself, Deputy Convener, just that need for clarity that feels overdue from government about how they'll discharge their responsibilities in the years to come.
Shona actually used the word dire in her editorial, which I think perhaps better sums up the situation. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I then draw this morning's evidence session to a close? Tricia Meldrum, you want to come back in?
Sorry, can I make a correction to my
Certainly.
Evidence to Mr. Simpson? When we talked about the compulsory redundancy, he asked which college. That should have been City of Glasgow College. So apologies, I think I said another college.
Yeah, I think you said it was Clyde, but it is City of Glasgow. That's fine. And no, appreciate you correcting the record. And can I therefore thank Sheila Stewart, Tricia Meldrum, Mark McPherson and the Auditor General for your time and the evidence you've given us this morning. And can I just conclude by saying how valuable I think this annual briefing is, because it gives us a snapshot in a short, sharp, very informative format of the state of Scotland's colleges, and I think I can speak on behalf of the committee and say we welcome this as an annual event, because it really does show how things are, how things have not moved on, where things have moved on, and we find it a very valuable resource as a committee to look at the state and the health of Scotland's colleges.
I mean, we're very grateful for that feedback. Thank you. And so we've used this model now for the past few years. Previously, we did overview reports. I think we took a year of a break from the sector. So we're going to give a bit of thought to where we go next, just so that consistency isn't lost, and you know, how we discharge our role, both in terms of insurance, but also kind of where we might play a part in kind of helping move some of the issues that feel quite stuck further on. So, but thank you. We'll take that away.
OK, well, thank you very much indeed. And I'm now going to move the meeting into private session. Thank you.